Tonight with that chilling piece of video live streamed on Facebook in the moments after a man is shot by police. His girlfriend in the car pulling out her phone and then capturing the moments right after. Her exchange with the police officer. Now seen by millions across this country, the pictures coming in now here in New York City of protesters gathering near Union Square. And just a short time ago, the governor of Minnesota asking, would this have happened if those passengers were white? He said, I don't think so. We begin with ABC's Gio Benitez in Minnesota.
Stay with me.
This is Diamond Reynolds streaming live on Facebook from her cell phone just moments after her boyfriend, Philando Castile, was shot by police during a traffic stop over what she says was a broken taillight. She says Castile told the officer he was carrying a licensed gun.
He's licensed to carry. He was trying to get out his ID and his wallet out his pocket, and he let the officer know that he was... He had a firearm and he was reaching for his wallet, and the officer just shot him in his arm.
The police officer pointing his gun into the car. Reynolds calm and clear, her young daughter in the back seat.
I'm waiting for a back. I will, sir. No worries. I will. He just shot his arm off. We got pulled over on Larpiner.
I told him not to reach for it. I told him to get his hand open.
You told him to get his ID, sir, and his driver's license. Oh my God, please don't tell me he's dead. Please don't tell me my boyfriend just went like that.
Keep your hands where they are, please.
Yes, I will, sir. I'll keep my hands where they are. Where's my daughter? You got my daughter?
Then officers, guns drawn, order Reynolds out of the car.
Get on your knees. Get on your knees.
Now on the ground, she never stops live streaming.
They threw my phone, Facebook.
Police performed CPR on Castile on the street. Reynolds now detained in a patrol car, her cell phone still recording.
I don't know if he's okay or if he's not okay.
Her daughter still with her. Reynolds finally breaks down.
I can't really do because they got me handcuffed.
It's okay, mommy.
I can't believe they just did this. I'm
It's okay, I'm right here with you.
Philando Castile, a supervisor at a school cafeteria where kids loved him, was taken to the hospital and died. Diamond Reynolds says she was held by police until 5 o'clock this morning.
This is where the shooting happened.
That brings us all to tears, watching something like that, especially with a 4-year-old in the back of the car. And you hear this child comforting her mother. You know? Of course, the Facebook video, she's very cool and calm, but she finally loses it when she's all alone with her and her baby. Amazing. The strength of black women under all circumstances. They're usually our rock. But the little girl was even more powerful. The state of black America in the Trump era. Well, this has been going on
Trump.
Forever.
Yeah, we don't have to. Yeah, we don't have to deal with Trump. The first.
This is. But Sessions.
The first shooting.
But Sessions has gotten in here and turned everything completely around. The progress we had made.
Well, we don't. We don't even know. I was going to say the first police shooting that I was involved in was July 1964 in Harlem. That was James Powell, shot by Officer Gilligan, was his name.
64.
July 64, which was the beginning of the Harlem Rebellion, the rebellion that took place in Harlem in 64. That was the first shooting that I was involved in. So that's 53 years ago.
Wow.
So we don't have to talk about the Trump era, or we don't have to talk about the Obama era, or we don't have to talk about the Clinton era. I mean, we can go all the way back, you know, 64. You know, we were talking about 64 is Johnson. You know, Kennedy had been assassinated, right. So that's Johnson. So, I mean, we can keep going back and we fought.
You go back further than that.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Well, and one of the things I think that people don't know.
Let's stay in the 21st century.
Yeah.
I think we got enough to deal with here.
See, but I think one of the things...
This is the year of this video cam.
Yeah.
Back in those days, they could easily cover it up.
Cover it up.
Well, we're talking about them getting off scot-free with a video of their performance. Now, how is that happening?
Well, I was in part of a forum a few months ago, and I was telling people, no two people can see the same thing. I don't care if you're looking at the same thing, you cannot see what I'm seeing, and I can't see what you're seeing. It's impossible.
Mm.
I was at the scene of an armed robbery and didn't know there was a gun. I knew there was a robbery, I didn't know the gun was involved.
Mm-hmm.
And my partner failed to cue me and give me the signal for the gun. And we got into a rock and roll situation with these guys. I wound up leaving him on a subway platform in 110th and Lenox, chasing a guy through the tunnel to 116th Street between two uptown and downtown trains. I didn't find out about the gun until after I caught my guy at 116th, and they said, well, Robbie has the guy with the gun. I'm like, what gun? I'm watching the same robbery, but from where I'm standing, I never saw the gun.
You never saw it.
Same thing with a video camera. A video camera is going to give you the view only from the police officer's perspective, and of that, only in the range that the camera can shoot, in terms of width and height. If I kicked you, I don't think it would show up on the video camera, but if I kicked you and you suddenly made a move on the camera, and then I could say, well, he made a furtive move, so I did X, Y, Z. That's why when we see video, such as in the Eric Garner case, or going back 25 years in L.A. to when they beat Rodney King. You have a person who is shooting the entire scene, again, from an angle, but they can see the parties involved in the incident.
Yeah.
A police officer's camera is not going to show you
no.
the full incident. It's going to show it from that perspective. And it's very interesting that sometimes the camera is not on, or, you know, whatever the story is, but the dash cam in this case that we're now seeing for the first time
after
the incident.
Could have been doctored.
Well, if it were doctored, and this is where the Justice Department comes in, if the Justice Department and the FBI are doing their job, they can go through that tape and tell if it was spliced,
okay.
if anything was taken out of it. They have the technology to do that. They've always had the technology to declare a tape valid or tampered. And the officer, you know, I've stopped armed people on the street. I've done it. And the way in which I did it, well, it wasn't in a car, but it was on the street. And I stopped a guy on East 14th Street. I walked past him, I made a quick U-turn, and I said, I want to see some papers for the gun you're carrying. I was in uniform. I said, if your hand goes near your weapon, I'm going to put your heart on the other side of First Avenue. I said, where is your ID? He said, my ID is in my vest pocket. My jacket pocket. I said, okay, reach for it. But at that case, I had seen the gun. I knew where the gun was because I spotted it from across First Avenue. So he reached in his pocket.
What did you spot? How could you tell me?
I spotted the butt of his gun.
You saw the bulge?
Yeah. The bulge. I saw the wind blew and I saw it. And other cases where I've just seen, no, that's a gun. And each time. But this was not the first of a couple of incidents where I stopped a guy, and the guy was an FBI agent. He opened his ID. I said, okay. See, but the officer has to take control of the situation. Castile did mention to him, I am armed. I have a license. Okay. Where is your weapon? That should be the next question. Where is your weapon? My weapon is here. Where is there? Where is your ID? Well, my ID is here.
Okay,
reach for your ID.
Okay.
And allow him. Now, he may have to unbuckle the seatbelt. You know, because when you're in the car, you got to move around and get. So you very carefully, he should have given him instructions. Okay. And he had there wasn't a guy on the other side. There was a guy on the other side.
There was a guy on the other side.
Right.
Yes.
So now you got two lanes of fire.
Yeah.
God forbid anything happens. But the guy from the other side can get a different view, as opposed to the officer at the driver's door. Now, where is your identification, sir? It's in my rear left pocket. Okay, get your ID. Now, you're watching, so you can see, you know, the other hand stays up. Take out your wallet, hand them the ID. I have a problem with the video because there were no instructions given. The police officer is to give the motorist instructions. What, to preclude something like this even happening.
What happened was he stopped the car, he spoke to him, he said, let me see your ID, your registration. And then as he said that, Castillo said, well, you know, I'm licensed to carry a firearm while he's reaching for his ID. And the guy says, don't go for it, don't go for it, don't go for it, and he shoots him. So, obviously, that's why he got off, obviously, from the dash cam. Well, is that what you saw?
Well, just see, one of the things that...
Did you see the dash cam?
I saw the dash cam. Okay.
See, but there's something else here. The idea of a police officer giving proper instructions is critical.
Right, of course.
But the other thing is that there are courses that are taught for black men and women who are licensed to carry because the condition in terms of us carrying a gun is different than for white people carrying guns.
Right.
When if you're on 125th Street and you see a white man running down the street with a gun, the assumption is that that's law enforcement.
Yeah, of course.
If you see a black man running down the street with a gun, that the assumption is he's a criminal.
Right.
Now, this has, of course, caused police officers, black officers who've been on duty or off duty, taking police action.
Desmond Robinson.
It's cost them. It's cost them their lives.
That's right.
Or they've been shot and wounded. I mean, you know, the Del Debbio and Robinson, of course, a major, major case. But there are these specific courses because it's known that a black man with a gun is going to be perceived differently than a white man with a gun.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously we have to be very careful in regards to that.
Mm-hmm.
There was that video in Florida where a police officer asked the man to go ahead and get his license, and he went.
Shot him. He was going back
to the
vehicle.
He's going back to his car to get
the gas
license.
Station and shot him.
And
oh,
he got shot.
Yeah.
He says,
you shot me.
You shot me.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you going to, well,
he didn't die. But
yeah,
the whole thing was,
hmm.
is that, you know, too often in terms of, I guess, the kind of fear that we have is that we listen to the instructions and attempt to try to go ahead and follow them literally. So now, in the Castillo case, you know, the argument could be, well, first of all, the argument that's always made, the major defense in terms of police officers is all they have to do is say, I feared for my life.
That's not a justification.
No.
I've been in armed situation, armed. I had a guy get one of my guns from me. It slid down the pavement. He got to that gun before I could get to him. No shot fired. I had another gun. No shot fired. All right? I've had guys try to draw on me and my partner. No shot fired. All right? The problem is, number one, we've got some of the wrong people doing this job.
Uh-huh.
This is not about a check. It's not about because your grandfather. It's not about this stupid Roy Rogers and Dale Evans nonsense. You have to be called to this job.
Mm.
It ain't about your father, your grandfather, all that nonsense. No. If you're not called to this, you're as much of a liability and a danger to somebody than a person posing as a doctor and they're not even licensed and they're going to do surgery on you. All right? You have to be truly called, not some notion you had as a child. Oh, the policeman, I want to have a gun. It's not what that is. And unfortunately, they've given a green light where an officer simply has to say, I was in fear of my life.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you're afraid, stay home with your mother. Go get a job at Tom McCann selling shoes. This is not for you. If you are that scared that you automatically go to the gun. The gun is the last tool in the box, and what a lot of these officers are doing, they're going to the bottom of the box to pull that out first. You need to know how to handle yourself with your brain, your hands, and your feet. We don't have that today.
Mm.
And we tried to get the transit police to move over to Aikido in defensive training. Mm-hmm. All right? They didn't think it was necessary.
What's
Most guys out there, Aikido is You've seen Steven Seagal movies. Steven right. Seagal, that's the form of martial arts that he uses.
Oh, that's Aikido. Oh, okay.
You know, but they didn't think it was necessary. Baton training, hitting people over the head and all that stuff, nah. The training needs to be upgraded in terms of handling yourself with your two hands and your two feet. I fought guys 100 pounds heavier than me and 4 inches bigger with my hands. No gun, all right? No nightstick. Fought them with my hands and took them down. But everybody has different capabilities. I'm not going to say everybody is a black belt. No. But where a cop can say, I was scared for my own life, so I killed somebody, that's not a justification.
Were you ever in a situation where you had fear?
Yeah, but you have to know how to handle the fear.
Okay.
The fear can't handle you.
Okay.
There were times, you know, the job requires me to do X. I have to go ahead and do X.
All right. Let's let the people decide from... I'm sure they showed this to the jury, the dash cam.
Yeah.
You would think that was shown, right? Well, let's take a look at it.
Did they see it? Did the jury see it?
If they had, I mean, after watching this, he might have had a case. Because it's just misinterpretation of what the man was doing. And we can't see it. All right? We know he was reaching for his wallet, which we'll hear about. Run the second video, and we'll come right back at you.
Another phone back here. It's going to be out. You ever like
the
insurance?
Your face is shiny. You got a handkerchief?
Sir, I have to tell you, I do have a firearm
on me. Okay. Don't reach for it, then.
See? You see his partner backed up.
Mm-hmm. You got out of the way?
Don't pull it out! Go home! Fuck!
Oh, man, I can't.
Fuck!
Oh, my God!
Don't move!
Oh, my God!
Don't move!
Oh, my God! I'm shaking!
Don't move!
Don't move, baby!
Call three! Get the baby girl out of here!
Don't
fuck! Don't move!
Don't move, babe, please!
Fuck! Whatever you do. 21! Get up! Back here, call three! Shots fired! Fuck! Next, call three!
We got pulled over for a busted tail light in the back. And the police just, he's covered. He killed my boyfriend. He's licensed to carry. He was trying to get out his ID and his wallet out his pocket, and he let the officer know that he had a firearm and he was reaching for his wallet, and the officer just shot him in his arm. We're waiting for
that.
I will, sir. No worries. I will. He just shot his arm off. We got pulled over on Larpenter.
I told him to get his hand up.
You told him to get his ID, sir, his driver's license. Oh, my God, please don't tell me he's dead. Please don't tell me my boyfriend just went like that.
Keep your hands where they are, please.
Yes, I will, sir. I'll keep my hands where they are. Please don't tell me this, man. Please, Jesus, don't tell me he's gone. Please don't tell me that he's gone. Please, officer, don't tell me that you just did this to him. You shot four bullets into him, sir. He was just getting his license to and registration, sir.
Get the female passenger out!
Ma'am, exit the car right now with your hands up. You see your hands, exit now! Keep them up!
Walk backwards. 6910. 6921, I'm sorry. One adult female.
I mean, what you witnessed there is hopefully they showed it to the jury, you think?
Most likely. I mean, they showed it to the jury, but...
So it looked like the officer feared for his life?
Once they invoke that. And again, this is scripted. We know it's scripted at this particular point, because all officers involved in fatal shootings who go to trial, this is what they say.
First thing they tell them.
I feared for my life.
But he didn't see a gun.
See, that's another thing. You have to make an assessment, all right? A guy having a gun, a guy drawing a gun. We had an incident. We're at the scene of a shooting in Harlem, and it's in a hotel up on St. Nicholas. Can't remember the hotel, around 150th Street. And I see a guy standing at the end of the hallway watching us moving around. And he hasn't moved in a few minutes. Both of his hands are behind his back. I say, hey, man, let me see your hands. He just looks at me. Let me see your hands. He just continues to look at me. So one of the other guys turns. I said, I want to see your hands. He doesn't move. So I draw. And as I draw, his right hand comes down to his side. He has his weapon in his hand, cocked. Now, he could have shot any of us in the time that we were there. It's a .357 Magnum with a 6-inch barrel, cocked. Now, the other guys converged. I said,
well, why didn't you shoot him?
This is the reason why, Winston. You have to go from your arm being here.
Now, you'd only cop in on the force that wouldn't shoot somebody.
Your arm is down. Your arm is down. In order to get me, you have to bring it up.
But nobody...
I am already leveled off on you. Not only did I not shoot, the four other guys that were with me.
Didn't
nobody
shoot.
Fired.
Nobody shot.
I said, I'm taking the weapon. And I walked towards them. Everybody had their weapon drawn. I walked towards them. I took the weapon, dropped the hammer, turned him around, I cuffed him. The sergeant said, that's the way we do it. That was a white sergeant with two white cops and two black cops in plain clothes.
Well, that sounds like an MGM movie.
For Castile.
For what we're seeing out here.
For Castile now, his weapon is down wherever it was.
I don't think he had it on him. Did he have it? Did we ever
it
establish
was in his pocket. It was in his right front pocket, pants pocket. EMS found it in his pants pocket when they got there. So now, your pocket, you got to go dig in your pocket to get a gun. All right? That's no threat to the officer. All right? He had to go into his front, and they said it was in the front right pants pocket. That's where his gun was. So even if he goes for it, the officer has time to make an assessment. I can't shoot you with the gun. Even if I want to shoot you from the pocket, I got to maneuver the gun around to fire the shot. He didn't take the time to make a full assessment. The fact that you're scared is not a justification for shooting somebody at all. Think, you have a man in the car, a woman in the car, a child in the car. How many people ride around with their families trying to kill police officers? Not that it can't happen or it hasn't happened, but you have to make an assessment of the situation. And this is what is lacking in these shootings. The officers are not making assessments. They're talking about they're scared. They have no business being in the
department. So the officer is Hispanic. So you would think he'd be a little bit more understanding?
A lot of them are as flaky as anybody else.
Why? Why?
Flaky.
I mean, because in terms of fatal shootings, they're white officers.
And black.
They're Latino officers. They're black officers.
Okay. It's just cop spirit.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, if we go back to Amadou Diallo, I mean, it's the same thing.
One, yeah.
We have a wallet.
There was no wallet.
There was.
And, you know, the issue is he's reaching for identification, and it's like, they think it's a gun.
Well, being a police officer.
That's the lie they told, because there was no wallet, there was no beeper involved.
Well,
he wasn't reaching for anything.
And it was too late at night to tell that.
They shot him because he observed a clandestine meeting between those four cops and occupants of two
We've
other
gone
vehicles.
Over this.
All right? I know this because I've interviewed witnesses and gave it to the FBI and it never got into court. All right?
Yeah.
There were federal agents surveilling one of the cars that those four cops met with that night. Federal agents were surveilling them. And they witnessed the shooting, but they don't intervene in a local matter. Mm-hmm. Plus, they have to maintain the eye on the people they were surveilling in a black Mercedes with diplomatic plates. That's
heavy.
The true story.
Right?
Amadou saw something he shouldn't have seen, and those four cops walked over and executed. He never went and retreated into the doorway, anything. I went through the bullet pattern in that doorway, and all of the rounds that were fired from straight on and from a 45-degree angle. If he retreated to the door in the vestibule, why are all the bullets in the front right door jammed? If the target is in the rear left corner, they lied. Mm. Moving right along.
And we actually did a good show on that.
Well, it sounds like it because, you know, the things that are coming up that I didn't know.
I found bullets 42 and 43 10 days after the shooting.
Well, they're in the back room.
One in the
and
front right
door
jammed.
And his roommate didn't even know that he had been shot. They took him down and interrogated him in the precinct. And they didn't tell him that Amadou was dead.
They didn't tell his roommate that they killed him. They wanted him to come up with a name of somebody that had it in for Amadou so they could go and stick that person for the shooting. That's what they did. Absolutely.
Yeah, I understand. I mean,
these kinds of things, you know, raise the issue of, in instances where we have cases of police violence or police misconduct, there needs to be a special prosecutor all the time. That local district attorneys, they are not capable of bringing these particular cases. And we see it all the time.
Right. Mm.
So there has to be a special prosecutor in all of these instances because of the incestuous relationship between the police department and the DA's office.
Yeah. Yeah.
So when, you know, even if you get an indictment, and very often you don't get an indictment, if you get an indictment, very often the case does not go as it should because in many instances, they do not prosecute these cases as strongly, as competently as they should.
So this dash cam recording is what got the officer off, you think?
Yeah.
Because of the
fact, him saying, don't reach for it, don't take it, don't.
Right. That's it. But why would he do that?
Let me tell you something.
I mean, I can't understand this one. You saw him standing right there. He was quiet. He was reserved. He didn't seem like he was angry at anybody. He was calm.
You notice his partner never fired a shot.
Right. Because he knew that he had a wife and there were two women.
His partner has the view from the right side.
So he could see if he was going in his pocket.
All right. He has the view from the right side. His partner backed up when he started shooting. You saw him back up behind the vehicle.
Right.
Now, I know he must be saying to himself,
why did he shoot?
What the heck is going on?
What are you shooting for?
Now, one of the problems that we have in regards to many of these cases, for instance, if we look at Freddie Gray in Baltimore, you know, people talk about the fact that, well, it's only a few bad apples that are going ahead and, you know, making these particular mistakes, as people might say. You know, it's only a few bad apples that are doing this. But we know it's not a few bad apples. It's the entire system. Because in the Freddie Gray case, if there's six officers, somebody saw something.
Right.
Now, the whole thing is, they're under test, you know, they're under oath, they testify, and one of the things, it's in police jargon, they talk about it, there's something called test the lying. Mm-hmm. Mm. Lying test under the oath. Test the lying.
Test the lying.
All right?
Mm.
So they do it.
That was three blacks and three whites.
Didn't make a difference. Because
you had a black sergeant at Eric Garner's incident who did absolutely nothing but other than watch.
And she got brought up on
They demoted charges. Her. They demoted her.
She got
her
brought up on disciplinary.
Yeah.
Because she stood there with her mouth open. She didn't know what to do.
Failure to supervise, you lose your stripes. You're done.
Mm-hmm.
Vanatero, okay? What happened to him?
He's still working.
Is he still working?
He still has his job. He hasn't been terminated as yet. And I was just watching a press conference at the U.S. Attorney's Office today in the Southern District. Reverend Sharpton, Mike, and the family of Eric Garner demanding that the Department of Justice do their job and declare what is going on. The Department of Justice never makes a statement as to where they are with an investigation. And I've been down there, and I know. We filed cases, and they've told us flat out, Or are we going to hit? No, we don't talk to anybody. So the only way you'll find out is if they come out and say, we filed an indictment against this person. But if you don't get that, you know the case has gone nowhere.
Mm.
So now we have Sessions with his comic book mentality, who we know has been lying ever since the first hearing before his appointment. He was lying. So I don't see the Department of Justice really getting into some. And Preet Bharara was terminated here in New York.
Mm-hmm.
All right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure Staten Island falls into the Southern District.
Yeah, it's got to.
The Southern District, not the Eastern District. So Preet Bharara is gone. And the question is, who is handling that case now?
Mm.
Trump has tried to get rid of 40, they got rid of 48 U.S. attorneys across the country. But do keep in mind that in spite of Sessions, there are people in the U.S. Attorney's Office, the FBI, and other intelligence groups that don't care about who the president is. They're going to do what they got to do.
That's right.
And Trump has played a dangerous game in messing with these people.
That's right.
Because there's nothing we love better than to take down a big name person.
That's right.
We
He's
love that.
He's going down. But
and they're going back more than 10 years on Trump. They're not looking at the campaign.
That's right.
They're going back to his daughter's involvement with Jared because her father was broke. She married Jared, which brought money back in to prop him up and get him going. And Jared brought the Russian bankers to him.
Right.
All right, Jed's family comes from Russia. This other guy, Boris, with a funny name, it's a Jewish name, but they put a Y in Epstein with an S-T-Y. His family's from Russia.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look at the genealogy of the people, you'll see the connections to Russia with a lot of these people. So they're not just looking at Trump from 2016 to 2017.
Mm-hmm.
They're definitely going back. And they're going through phone records. They're going through everything because when they slap him, he's not going to recover from it.
All right, let's go to another officer that was acquitted in the Louisiana case, Alton Sterling.
Sterling.
Remember that case? All right, run the video on Alton. Give you another a man with a gun in his pocket. Was he licensed?
I don't remember. That's when they shot him on the ground.
Within just a couple of seconds, the confrontation escalates. 37-year-old Alton Sterling, a black man, is pinned down by two white police officers outside the Triple S Food Mart in North Baton Rouge. Someone yells, "Gun!" Then,
they shot him. Oh my goodness!
Video of Tuesday morning's shooting, recorded by witnesses inside a nearby car, was posted on social media and sparked protests in the neighborhood. Sterling died of multiple gunshot wounds to the chest and back. His son, Cameron Sterling, and the young man's mother made a powerful appearance before reporters.
The individuals involved in his murder took away a man with children who depended upon their daddy on a daily basis. My son is not the youngest. He is the oldest of his siblings. He is 15 years old. He had to watch this as this was put all over the outlet.
Abdullah Muflahi, the owner of the Triple S Food Mart, says he allowed Sterling to sell CDs and DVDs outside his store and says he never saw Sterling get into a confrontation with anyone. Muflahi says he's not aware of any incident on Tuesday morning which would have prompted a 911 call from someone saying Sterling had threatened them with a gun.
Seven CDs on the corner, gun in his pocket. He pulled a gun on a complainant and told him he couldn't be around there.
The store owner, who says he witnessed the shooting, says the officers slammed Sterling against a car and tased him before shooting him.
I did not see him.
Muflahi says the officers pulled a gun out of Sterling's pocket. The two officers involved have not been on the Baton Rouge police force for very long, one for 3 years, one for four. The Justice Department's Civil Rights Division is leading the investigation. The FBI and U.S. Attorney's Office are also involved. Louisiana Congressman Cedric Richmond had been pressuring the feds to take on the case.
What are the unanswered questions that you have that you think need to be answered right now?
Well, one, if he was tasered, what happened when he was tasered? Two, was he reaching for a gun? Three, where was the gun? Four, what type of treatment did
One of the things we have to say is that the Justice Department, under Eric Holder and Loretta Lynch, decided that they were not going to go after individual police officers, that they were going to go after entire police departments.
And
what they would attempt to do is, bring reports, do the investigation, and litigate to the extent where the city and the police department had to enter into what's called a consent decree.
Right.
And that is where the city and the police department agree with the federal government that certain changes are going to be made in the police department.
Okay.
So, I mean, this happened,
what happened in Ferguson.
Okay. Happened in Chicago.
Okay.
Was happening, yeah. Was
Philadelphia.
Happening, Philadelphia.
And
was
Baltimore,
happening in Baltimore. Yeah.
Okay.
Now, on one hand, you know, this is good in terms of some kind of systemic change, but it, in many instances, takes the individual police officers off the hook. Because if they're not going to be actually convicted in a local court, it's only the feds that are going to be able to go ahead and bring and get the conviction.
That's right.
So what's happening with Eric Garner?
That was the question today in front of the U.S. Attorney's in front of the Southern District. Why are they taking so long? Why is it that no information has come forth? They don't give information. The only thing is, as I said, if they move forward and indict, we do what's called an indictment arrest. The indictment is filed before the arrest is done. Most times people are arrested, then they're indicted.
Mm-hmm.
There are times when we will leave the person alone, we'll indict you, then we get a Supreme Court warrant, come pick you up. And in this case, it would be a federal district warrant to arrest the person, then bring them in, fingerprint them, and photograph them, and put them in. Mm-hmm. The Justice Department does not give out any information. They don't even tell you if the case is over.
Right.
And this is the question. So it is unfortunate, but they don't tip their hand one way or the other. They're not going to say whether or not they've got stuff on Pantaleo. We know Pantaleo didn't have a stellar record. And conversely.
And what about the fact that Pantaleo and Eric Garner had a history?
Right, there was a history there.
There's a history there.
There was a history.
How come that's not brought out?
Well, remember, there was no trial. There was no indictment.
There's no indictment.
Remember, you had a crooked congressman in Staten Island.
Right. That's
who
right.
went to federal, who is now in federal prison. You had a crooked DA who took the job of the crooked congressman. Mm. And the crooked DA did not get an indictment, did not choose to seek to get an indictment.
Where is that congressman?
So there was no trial.
Where is that congressman?
The former DA is the congressman representing Staten Island.
What was that name?
I don't remember his name. So this is, you know, you have to observe and stay on top, not only of what's going on, but who's doing it.
Yeah.
And here is a man who beat justice down and went to the U.S. Congress.
Mm.
The good thing to ask yourself is, what type of bills is he promoting? Who is he supporting?
I forgot his name.
As a representative of Staten Island, you know.
Mm.
But it is all so critical. Staten Island is a problem place. It's a world unto itself. A world unto itself. And I've had a couple of run-ins with white people in Staten Island over the years just being there, you know. But they think they're in another country in Staten Island.
Well, Staten Island's always been like that.
Yeah.
I've never known it to be any different. You stay away from Staten Island.
Yeah, but there are a number, good number of black people that live there.
I know.
There are a lot of immigrants that live on Staten Island, a lot of African people in the Park Hill area. Yes.
And I have a daughter who lives in Staten Island.
Oh, wow.
I have a daughter, not that often, and it's not because it's Staten Island.
You have any stories to tell?
No real stories. I mean, I have had no problems in regards to, you know, the neighborhood that they live in. And moving in and out of Staten Island.
So there's hope for Staten Island.
You know, hey.
Every place.
One of the things, though, that this points out again is the need for a special prosecutor. If there had been a special prosecutor, then the whole process of getting an indictment would have been taken away from that DA to begin with. He wouldn't have had to do it.
Just like Mueller with the investigation.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he is going to do and dig as far down as he has to go.
Mm.
He's not going to leave a stone unturned. And truthfully, the FBI agents who worked under Comey are going to do everything they can to make sure that Mueller gets to the bottom of that, because Comey was revered by the agents in the FBI. He was revered. Mm. So, you know, all that Trump talk.
Yeah, despite what Trump said.
Yeah, that Trump talk is nonsense.
Well, you know, we'll finish this up with showing us Eric Garner to just round out.
in the Louisiana shooting.
Okay.
If you get a chance, go back and look at it. You will see there's an officer standing in front of him talking, and the other officer lunges at him and knocks him.
In the beginning.
You'll see. Yeah. Now, that officer escalated the situation.
Right.
Why? There was no further, the gentleman is standing there talking to the officer. Even if he had a gun, he's not trying to reach for it, he's not doing anything. He's talking. Maybe
but somebody called 911.
Somebody called 911. That doesn't mean the person has a gun. I got a 911 call about a man with a gun at the Delancey Street station with a detailed description. And I'm sighted on the guy, and he's like, I just want to, don't put your hand in your pocket. All right? The guy turned out to be an auxiliary cop. Somebody that didn't like him called in the 911 call. Had I overreacted to his movement to go to the pocket, he'd have been dead. And people do that. They will call the police, hoping that the police will come and kill you in the process. But what the officer, the other officer who was off to the side, he never should have tackled him. You have two officers there. Sir, turn around, put your hands on the car.
Right.
That's it.
That's it.
Put your hands on the car. Pat down, you find the gun, cuff him, you take him. There's no reason. Same thing with Pantaleo. These guys are running and jumping in people and escalating a situation that's totally unwarranted.
Pantaleo just stood there patiently and waited for for backup so he could jump on Eric Garner.
And choke him.
And choke him to death.
Which is, it's an illegal hold.
It was a murder.
It's a felony crime to restrict a person's airway or blood flow to their brain. It's a felony.
We're going to watch Eric Garner, but I want you to carefully watch what happens here. Eric has been selling Lucy's. Been known he had a history with Panatello. That run into each other. I think he had a case against Panatello.
Pantaleo.
Pantaleo, right. And so these two knew each other. Now, if you look at the beginning of the video, you'll see Pantaleo standing behind him, patiently with his arms crossed, waiting for his backup. All right, so run the video and watch it carefully. We're watching again on Murder Live on video.
That's another thing.
Wait for what? Every time you see me, you want to mess with me. I'm tired of it.
It
stops today.
This guy right here is forcibly trying to lock somebody up for breaking up a fight.
Everybody's standing here, they told you I didn't do nothing. I did not sell nothing. Because every time you see me, you want to harass me, you want to stop me, you want to sell cigarettes. I'm minding my business, officer. I'm minding my business. Please just leave me alone. I told you the last time. Please just leave me alone. Don't touch me. Don't touch me.
Damn.
All right, stop.
Put your hand,
buddy.
Put your hand behind your back. I can't breathe.
Once again, police beating up on people.
Back up right here. Back up and get on that step.
Okay.
Back up.
All he did was break up a fight. And this is what happens for breaking up a fight. This shit is crazy.
Everybody back up, back up.
He can't breathe. Look, now, man, they gave this man a seizure.
Yo, move out the way. Yo.
It's my brother. We live here.
Back up this way. Everybody now back up. It's now going to become a crisis. Back it up. Back it up.
I'm going to my house.
This way. Let's go.
Can't go
in
my house.
The house or that way?
All right, I call it that way.
Pick a choice.
Let me get my bike.
You had your chance to get your bike, sir. Stand over there right now. We have a seat.
Now you know the only person in jail
is the guy who did the video.
Yeah. Right.
I was going to talk about that.
Mm-hmm. He's the only one in jail.
You see Pantaleo right at the end there, the guy in the green shirt. Now this guy is still has his job. He's still wanting to get back to work, I understand. He's voting out. He has a lawyer trying to get him back on the job. You said he's working. He's still working, right?
There were so many crimes committed here.
He's getting paid. All right.
There were so many crimes committed here. We witnessed the homicide.
Mm-hmm.
You had a man saying, I can't breathe.
Right.
It is a felony to restrict the airway or the blood flow to a person's brain. That's a crime.
Okay.
That's a crime. All this BS about the chokehold. There is no training. That law has been on the books for years. All right? It's not about they have to revisit it and do this, that, and the other. The law has been on the books for years. Now,
also, I had a cop deny that that was a law.
Well, this is why we need to study law. This is why young folks need to be in school studying. So when these matters come up, it can be addressed. Also,
just clear this up for me. Because at a protest out there, when we went out there with National Action Network, I went up to a lieutenant and I said, well, isn't it illegal to choke a man to death? And he said, no, that's no law against that.
He's wrong.
He was wrong.
Wrong. It's a felony. All right? First of all, you have to have a situation where deadly physical force can be used.
So we saw a felony being performed.
This was multiple felonies were performed here. Multiple felonies. The restriction of the airway, the restriction of the blood to the brain. Another crime. The torture. When you exhibit a depraved indifference for human life, when you hear a man saying, I can't breathe, I can't breathe, I can't, and you disregard the man's cry, that is torture. Okay. It is an additional charge. Okay. All right? Every time a man says, I can't breathe, and you're saying to him, I don't give a damn if you can't breathe, I'm going to keep you in this condition.
And you see how he's crushing his head.
Yeah, pressing. Another thing, compression. You have to be able to inhale. The fat cop that was on him, all of those guys, as big as Pantaleo was, it wasn't a matter of his diabetes, asthma, or being overweight. If you have 600 or 700 pounds of pressure from people on top of you, you can't inhale. There's no way in the world, because your rib cage and your diaphragm have to expand in order for you to breathe. All of this could have been brought out in a trial. Never brought out in a trial, because you had a crooked DA that made sure that this cop was protected. There are so many crimes also, nonfeasance. When a police officer sees a crime being committed in his presence, it is his legal duty to prevent the crime from being committed. There were cops standing there. Not one of them said, okay, wait, hold up. This guy's big. He's already on the ground. It's not like he's going to run away. All right, everybody, back off. He's on the ground. You got him on the ground. We'll cuff him on the ground. Nobody said that. They sat there and watched it. You had a sergeant who was a supervisor who failed to supervise and allowed this man to die on the sidewalk. But none of this was brought out in a court of law because you had a crooked DA. And all the more reason why we need special prosecutors on the federal level and on the state level, because too often our people have been victimized and the state did nothing to protect the victim or the victim's family.
Now, the chokehold was outlawed by NYPD after the Lavoti case, after the Baez case.
The state legislature outlawed that.
So Lavoti had gone ahead and used the chokehold.
Early 90s.
I'm trying to remember how early.
And Lavoti had 14 prior complaints against him.
Okay.
But he was protected because his uncle was the Manhattan North Borough Commander. He was involved in some
dirt. Anamone.
Thank you. And Anamone is the one that put together We Rule the Night.
He
put that unit together.
And that Lavoti actually, when he was on patrol, he was in a force monitoring unit. He was actually supervised by a sergeant because he had all these complaints against him.
And it's about a baseball hitting a car.
Football.
He should have been terminated, but because his uncle was an inspector.
See? So he jumps out of the patrol car and chokes the guy to death.
Over a football.
Because the football hit the car.
Yeah.
I was in the car once. We were in the Lower East Side. A kid threw an M80 under the sector car. He know an M80, man. The whole car rocked. Fortunately, it wasn't by the fuel tank.
Wow.
You know, so we got out. I said, well, you think this is a joke? What, are you crazy? And the kids would, you know, laugh. I said, the car could have blown up. And probably you would have gotten hurt, too. With the explosion. But we didn't do anything to them. We got back in the car and kept going. I had a guy throw a firecracker at me once on a subway station. He threw it. It was behind me. Pow! It sounded like a gunshot. And I literally leaped in the air, and I came down with my gun in my hand. And he was just... I had two incidents like that. We were handcuffing a guy in the Bronx, and the guy threw two or three firecrackers at us. Pow, pow, pow! I spun around. The sound is so loud in the subway station, it was near a telephone booth,
that's right.
It sounds like a gunshot.
That's right.
And my partner said, I didn't know you could get your gun out that fast. I said, if I'm being shot at, believe me. But, you know, but even there, as I spun, I had to make an assessment. We heard the shots. What we thought were shots, I have to make a quick assessment because there's only one person standing there. So am I going to shoot this guy or am I looking to see if he's holding a weapon?
I have to say that Witherspoon is in the film Every Mother's Son, where he talks about the Lavoti case. He's asked some questions in regards to that.
Really?
So he's in the film.
But we are, when we've come to a point in this country that we can see people summarily murdered on video.
Yeah.
And
we just showed up.
And all a person has to say was, I was in fear for my own life and safety. Mm-hmm. How can you do your job if you're not willing to risk your life for somebody? Because if your first instinct is to protect your own life, you'll never go to save another person that really needs your help. You'll never do that. And for the New York State Legislature, and this is where people need to be, they need to get on their game here. There are lobbyists in Albany, and there are lobbyists in Washington, and they deal with the legislators on writing law. ALEC, A-L-E-C. Look that group up, A-L-E-C. It's an acronym. I can't remember. It's a legislative something. I can't remember. American Legislative something. But they are helping to write the laws that are affecting people across this country.
Funded by the Koch brothers.
The Koch brothers.
Oh.
Precisely.
Huh.
So those lobbyists are in Albany. They're pushing for legislation to protect police officers. No, police officers are not, you know, we're not anti-cop. We just need, we want the right people doing the job.
That's right.
We want, and I don't want to see black cops getting the job who are going to be as much of a problem as some of the old whites were.
That's right.
I don't want to see some of these Latino cops because some of them are flaky too.
We just saw
We need decent people doing the job. It's not based upon race. It's based upon the character of the individual.
Yeah, amen.
Amen.
And we've seen a decline in incidents with Jimmy O'Neill as commissioner as compared to Bratton and Kelly.
Is between cops?
Yeah, incidents with police officers. You haven't, since
you
Jimmy
haven't
O'Neill.
You haven't seen any incidents?
You haven't. We've had shootings, but there were no crazy incidents where, oh, he didn't have a gun, he didn't have this. No, we haven't had that since Jimmy O'Neill took office.
Okay.
Took over as commissioner. And the fish stinketh from the head. The leadership comes from the top.
I thought you were going to get him on the show.
I'm trying to do that. The guy is so busy, man. It's unbelievable. But I've known him for over 30 years. I knew him when he was a rookie cop.
That'd be interesting.
But he was born and raised in Brooklyn. He's not a foreigner to New York.
That's it.
You know, and he did not like what he was seeing. Didn't like what he was seeing.
What about the residency requirements of officers here in the
Exists in Nassau and Suffolk. Don't know why it doesn't exist, but this is why. Because you have lobbyists for the Metropolitan Police Conference and other groups, because the PBA wanted to get out, the members of the police department wanted to exit New York when New York was crashing and burning back in the 70s.
Okay.
So they got the law changed so they could escape the city.
Right.
Right? I can't get a job working in Nassau County because I live in Brooklyn. It's a 20-minute ride from my house to Nassau County. I can't work there because I live in Brooklyn. They have a residency requirement. So
but they can work here.
But they can work here. They can work here. So people need to be on top of their assemblymen. People need to understand that you have to have someone exerting your desires in Albany. And our people don't have that. We don't have lobbyists that are pushing for specific matters concerning our community.
Time to go.
Hey.
Gentlemen, it's been a good review of what's happening. The Sterling, all of the cases are
amazing.
The God in me, loves in God in you, and stay tuned for more of the Gilchrist Experience. We'll come back next week and find some other topic that where there's abuse and no justice, no peace. Power to the people. God bless.
Simsalabim Saeed.
That was a good one.
Hey.
So you got the right person here, man. Yeah, he can talk about all those law enforcement experiences, man.
Yeah, all the time.
it's
we did the lot.
And I'm going to tell you something else.
A long time.
In New York, I had a lieutenant tell me, why didn't you just shoot the guy? No, you could have got a combat medal. So we're fine.
Yeah.
These guys had.